from the Mahabharata, an epic poem. There was a king in India named Aswapati, and his people loved him for he helped all in need and served the shining gods with prayer and sacrifices. But the king had no child in whom his name and line could live on, and his heart was very sad. So he fasted often and sent hymns to the shining gods, hoping they would grant the one wish. After 16 years, his prayers were answered. In the red fire of the altar, he saw a woman, fair of face and of mind.
"Your devotion has pleased me," she said. "State your wish and it will be granted."
"My wish is to have a child who will live after I am gone,"
replied the king.
"The gods will grant you that wish," she said,
and then she was gone, and the king fled. And one day, this maiden of grace, so beautiful, knelt by the altar of Aiko, god of the red flame. She asked the gods' blessings and laid before him an offering of cakes and drink. Then she gathered a bunch of flowers to take to her father. Aswapati looked at her with tender eyes.
"My daughter, it's time you were married, as is the fashion of all highborn ladies. We must lose no time, as people might think it is my fault that no husband has been chosen for you. Since no one has come to seek your hand, I suggest you travel and select one for yourself."
So Savitri began her search. She traveled in a splendid train, accompanied by nobles and wise men. The royal procession passed through forests and moved along streets of great cities, and journeyed even through small villages in the hills. Wherever Savitri went, she gave alms to the poor and greeted the mighty and the lowly, and the people all blessed her. One day, she finally returned. The king greeted her from the throne. At his side sat Narad, the wise man.
"I have found my husband,"
the princess said.
"He is the Prince Satyavan. Even though he does not live in a palace, still he is a noble of royal blood."
"What land does he rule?"
the king asked.
"He has no kingdom, but lives in a cottage in the woods with his father and mother. Their lot is not a happy one. The old man is blind, and he and his queen have lived in the jungle since their son was an infant. Many years ago, the king's enemies drove him from his rightful throne and took away his lands. But my prince is a noble as his name. At his birth, the Brahmins called him Satyavan, or truth lover. He is manly and full of laughter, an excellent horseman, and he can paint pictures of horses that are a wonder to behold."
"What do you think?"
the king asked the wise man, Narad.
"She has chosen badly,"
Narad answered.
"The old king is indeed a just man, and the prince Satyavan a noble youth. But I see a dark fate awaiting them, for it has been shown to me by the shining gods that the prince will die a year from this very day. Do you hear that, my daughter? I beg you to select another. It will be foolish to go ahead with your marriage, since Yama, the god of death, will come in a year to claim your husband for his own."
"I can choose another, dear father. My heart belongs to Satyavan alone. Whether he is taken from me or not, I will marry only him."
"You may do as you want, my child. But it is a strange wish you have shown. You ask to live in the wilds for 12 months, then to spend the rest of your years in mourning."
The next day, the king and his daughter went into the jungle, accompanied by courtiers and priests, carrying with them a great treasure. They found the blind old king seated on a green mat beside a salt tree. At the blind king's request, Aswapati and his daughter sat down on the grass mat. The host offered his honored guest some water, for he was too poor to afford the customary wine. After cordialities, the two kings agreed upon the marriage, and not long afterwards, the prince and princess were married. The lovely maiden of a small cottage nestled in the trees of a vast jungle. Once the wedding was concluded, her friends and father said their farewells amid many tears. After her parents had gone, Savitri removed her sparkling jewels and her beautiful dress and put on a plain robe fashioned from the bark of trees. This she bound around her with a cord of cheap yellow cloth. She would be a queen, not by her jewels or dress, but by serving the blind old king and his wife, and by her love and obedience to the prince of her choice. So passed the happy year. Now, only 4 days remained before the shadow of death glides into the forest kingdom. For 3 of these days, Savitri fasted and went without sleep. Her heart was pained with the dread of death which had been preordained. But she told her story to no one, so neither the blind king nor the noble prince know of the fate that lay ahead. On the morning of that fatal day, Satyavan arose in a joyful mood. He took his woodsman's axe and smiled at his princess.
I'm off to cut some wood,
he announced.
I will be home again at the setting of the sun.
The prince's words broke Savitri's heart. She knew too well how the black-robed Yama would lay his hand upon her lover and so take him from her.
Let me go with you today, she said.
No, the ground is too rough for your dainty feet, and the way will be long, and the trip will be too exhausting.
Please, she begged. This prince Satyavan would not deny, and the prince and the princess set out for the depths of the jungle forest. They came to a distant place where there were many high trees forgotten and much fruit that could be gathered. The hour of noon had passed and dusk began to creep through the great forest. The sound of the axe echoed in the grove. Basket in hand, Savitri picked ripe berries from the shrubs. Again and again, she would stop and look over at her husband. Suddenly, he cried out,
"Oh, my wife!"
Savitri threw down her basket and rushed to his side.
"It's my head! A sharp pain is stopping at my brain. Look, now my blood is hot. Oh, I must lie down."
Savitri held him to a tree. Beneath the lynch, she laid his head in her lap and fanned his face. His eyes had been closed for many moments, when at last he fell silent. Then his pulse slowed, and finally it was still. The year had passed. The heartbroken Savitri looked up to see a huge shadow in the shape of a man. Its robe was black, its eyes shone like red lights, and it wore a strange crown on its head.
"Are you one of the gods?"
she asked in a whisper.
"Princess, I am Yama, the god of death. I have come this day for your husband, the prince."
At these words, Yama raised his hands and drew a cord at the steel form of Satyavan. The cord caught the life of the prince in its noose and drew it from his body. Then Yama turned towards his kingdom in the south. The jungle became dark, and the power of Yama was strong. But the princess was brave. She got up and followed in the footsteps of Yama. After a short time, the black tribe heard him. He turned.
"Go back. You have come too far. Go back and begin those sad rites which mourners make to show their sorrow for the dead."
"I follow my husband, the prince Richard. The wise men say that to walk 7 steps with another makes friendship. So let me walk more than 7 steps with you. Besides, the wise men tell that the way of righteousness is the way for all, and so it must be my way."
"Your loyalty and fidelity are great,"
Yama replied.
"In return for this, I will grant you one wish, any wish, except for the soul of the dead Satyavan."
"Then give me this. Let the eyes of my prince father once again see the light of day, and let his strength be as the strength of the sun itself."
"I shall be done,"
one more wish. Accept the soul of Satyavan. It shall happen as you say. And now go back. The forest is wide and your home is far off.
Yama, tell me once more. What is the goodness of a good man? Is it kindness to all the things on earth, in the air, or on the sea? It is indeed. So even if your enemy seeks help, grant him that help, for you by doing so you become good.
Your words are the words of wisdom, princess. And for this last words, I promise you still another wish. What will it be?
Oh, Yama, I only want to be the mother of a noble children, so that I can teach them to walk in the footsteps of their dear father, Satyavan, and for that, return my prince. The god of death shook his foot.
Woman, your husband shall reign with you for many years, and you shall have sons to reign after you.
The dark shadow of Yama then floated off into the gloom of the jungle. With quick feet, Salvitri ran. Breathless, she flew. And when she reached the tree where the body of Satyavan lay, she knelt. After putting his head on her lap, she waited and watched. At last, the prince opened his eyes.
Oh, I must have overslept. Strange. Just as I was falling asleep, I thought I saw something like a shadow. It reached out and grasped my life in some kind of magic noose. Then I was carried away to the darkness.
And this is Yama. The god is dead. Today is gone. Get up now, Satyavan. It is dark and you must go home.
Ah, now I remember. A sharp pain was piercing my brain.
We'll talk about it tomorrow. It's time to go.
It's too dark. We'll never find the path.
Look, she said. There is a fire burning in the forest a long way off. Perhaps it's the work of a blazing midday sun. We will head towards it. You can use the burning wood to make a torch so that we can drive off the wild beasts as we walk. But if your pain is still present, we can remain here until you recover.
The pain is gone so deeply. I am strong again. You are right. Father and mother will be worried by our absence.
As he spoke of his blind father, tears filled the prince's eyes. He jumped to his feet, brushing the dry leaves from his clothes.
Get your basket of fruit.
We'll get it tomorrow, Satyavan. We have enough to do to find our way. In the darkness. Here, let me carry the axe.
Savitri carried the axe in her left hand and put her right arm about her husband. In this way, they traveled through the jungle, harmed neither by bear nor tiger. The sky had turned to gray by the time Savitri and Satyavan reached the cottage. As they approached, they heard voices, and a shout arose as the prince and princess broke through the clearing.
My children!
Cried the king.
Father!
Shouted Satyavan.
How are you able to see me? I do not know how this miracle came about, but I do know that I can see you, my son, and you, dear Savitri. Now, I can look upon my feet and daughter for the first time.
The old king embraced his son and daughter-in-law.
Now, tell me,
he asked,
where have you two been all night?
After Satyavan explained their delay, Savitri told of the evil prophecy and of her encounter with Yama, the god of death. No sooner had she finished than a jumble of noises came from the forest, and a crowd of people did approach.
Good news!
They cried.
The tyrant who captured the old king's throne has been overthrown. Return to your kingdom, dear ruler. Even though you are blind, your loyal subjects stand by your side.
But the shining
lands and people of my birth.
And that is the story of Sumitri, of her meeting with the black god of death, and of her great love.